What is a robot behavior? You probably have an intuition about that. We can think of it as a sequence of actions the robot performs to complete a task. But now, how do we program it? How do we make our robot execute all those actions the specific way they need to be executed to complete the task? This is what behavior design is about, and we are going to learn about it in this unit. Let's start by understanding better the idea of robot behavior and why we need behavior design to create our robot applications. Consider a picking application. What does the robot need to do? What is the desired behavior in this example? Well, typically, first, the robot needs to locate the object to pick. Then it has to compute how to grasp it. Next, it has to move to the grasp pose, activate the gripper to grasp it, and finally, move back. So, to solve this task, the robot needs to perform a set of actions. These actions cannot be executed randomly. For example, the robot should not move to pick the object without first locating it. We need to coordinate the execution of these actions, in this case, in a sequence, so that the robot solves the task. The question here is, how do we program all this coordination? Let's consider how we can program all the individual actions with ROS. To detect the object, we can use some available vision package, as you learned in previous weeks, or create your own vision node. Anyway, let's assume there is a camera node that solves the vision problem. The same goes for computing the grasp pose to pick the object. This can actually be a very complex problem in robotics, requiring advanced deep learning or motion planning techniques, such as those used in the Amazon Challenge. We saw a video of it in the intro of this week. But let's assume we have a package available with a node, Grasp Planner, that outputs the joint values for the robot arm to pick the object, given as input the pose of that target object. For both move actions to pick and retreat, we can use the MoveIt services provided by the Move Group node, as you have also learned in this course. Finally, for grasping, we need a node that commands the gripper, a gripper driver, typically offering a ROS service for that. Let's assume we also have that component. Okay. We have these actions covered, but what about the coordination? Shouldn't there be another ROS node responsible for it? Well, such a coordination mechanism is more complex than the individual actions. Developing it is what we are learning this week. I will show you how to design a robot behavior and implement it with ROS. The first step is to design the behavior of your robot. To design or specify behavior, there are many methods available, coming from artificial intelligence and computer science. You might be familiar with finite state machines, for example, or flowcharts, but there are more, such as behavior trees, that are better suited for more complex behaviors. Which one to use depends on your needs, for example, the complexity of the behavior or its nature. Is it a sequential behavior, like in our picking example? Or will the robot be doing many things in parallel? But the choice can also depend on practical considerations, such as the ROS tools that are available for it, or your personal experience. We are not going into the details of all of these methods. You can find plenty of documentation and online courses to learn more about them. In this course, we will focus on the state machines, commonly used in robotics, which is a very popular and intuitive method to design robot behavior. State machine defines a behavior as a sequence of actions that are executed. During behavior execution, only one state becomes active at a time, and it has to finish execution before the state machine transitions to the next state. Therefore, basic state machines are appropriate to specify simple sequential behaviors. Each state represents an atomic action in the robotic application. For the execution of the action, the state may consume input data. For example, compute the grasp requires an object pose. And as a result of its execution, a state may produce outcome data. For example, the joint values for the robot arm to grasp the object. State machines are very popular because they represent the behavior in a visual and intuitive form. States are represented as blobs, and the transitions by arrows that connect the state blobs. To indicate the first state of a behavior, a transition is drawn from the entry point, which is represented as a filled circle, to the first state. The end of a behavior execution is represented with a transition to a double circle. Other symbols are also used, such as circle with a cross. Let's see how the state machines for our picking example looks like. These were the atomic actions we have defined for our application. So we add a state for each of them. And then we connect the states following the desired sequence of execution. Now, to complete the flow of execution for our behavior, we add the transition to the first state and to the behavior endpoint. Okay, are we done? Let's take a closer look. What do you think? Do you feel that this state machine solves the picking application? Maybe you feel that there are some things missing. For example, some of these states certainly need some input data to execute their actions. For example, to compute the grass pose to the pick object, we certainly need the object pose. This pose should probably be the result of the previous state that detects the object. To complete the behavior definition, we have to specify values for all the input and output data of the states. However, this detailed configuration of a behavior depends on the particular tool we use to create our robot state machine. For this reason, we will discuss them in the next unit, when we will introduce the FlexP behavior engine, the ROS tool we are going to use during the rest of the week. So stay tuned and start up your ROS installation, because we are going to create a robot behavior in the next videos.